Oh, it's just going to let it blink for a while. I think it goes away, hopefully. Okay, geological formative age. Pent up water. Yep. During another era in geological history, the permeability of the crust seems to have been more conducive to the flow of subterranean aquifers to the surface. Or something like that, you know. Either that or something else like the venting of aquifers by geyser-like activities in the age when hot spots in the crust were more than common. They were prolific. Now it's as if the crust, more aged, and due to seismic activity from certain things as lunar stress, you know, tidal lunar stress, reveals a more sealed, less permeable surface, so that extreme phenomena now persist like an ocean of potable fossil water beneath North Africa, and the mile-deep underground river flowing from New Zealand underneath Australia. You know, one must assume then that there are myriad of these. I'm almost sure there are thousands, if not millions, of these rivers and many more oceans beneath the Earth's surface. And we're not talking salt ocean here. This is fresh. Imagine a freshwater ocean. Huh? More oceans beneath the Earth's surface, probably with life, such as the extensive Loch Ness plesiosaur. It's as if the lithosphere had a circulatory system, like a multicellular organism would, you know, with a dominant percentage of water. But in litho baby, it's pure fossil, fresh, potable water. Litho baby, man, we've been all my life. Under, right down here, I've been here all the time. Oh yeah, that's right. Okay, so now what? Now what? Well, along comes man, the digger of the wells, and all's well that ends with wells. Yeah, along comes man, the digger of wells, and all's well that ends with wells. But, well, not so easy. Humankind is a coin. Bright side and shady side. The dark side of the coin, well, I don't know. The dark side of the coin is laziness. How else could you put it, huh? Most people just really hate to think. You know, be honest. As soon as they figure something goes, as soon as they figure something out, you know, up goes the infrastructure, and from then on, off goes the brain into idle mode, and is nothing more than life as usual, happily ever after, till death do they part. Yeah, well, not all oceans are pent up in the lithosphere. Have you ever heard of a great lake called Lake Coca-Cola? And Lake Pepsi-Cola, not to mention the small oceans of spring water, and now even distilled and municipal water, all in cute little aluminum or plastic cellular. Whoa, I'm having trouble pronouncing that, man. I hope I'm okay. I could get a CAT scan. Wow! Scan that one, will you? Okay. Okay, cellular. Well, I got it. Yeah, rubber face. Got a little dizzy on that one, too. In aquifers, not underground, but right on the surface, known as premises. Plural. Premises. Plural of a quasi-geologic colloquialism, premises. Even though it probably can't be measured, humankind figured out how to handle their little... how do I put it? Vendable. You know, you've heard of edible. This is vendable. Can you sell it? Their little vendable drinkies conveniently, you know. And there is where their fairy tale ends. No more thought. No more thought. Now they're actually taking the water from developing nations for their drinkies. Okay, that's right, Bunky. The well diggers are outnumbered by lazy brains in idle mode doing a crime called business as usual. They know deserts are growing, but they figure that's nature, and in their minds, humans are not a part of nature. And the lame excuse, don't interfere, is what they say. That's a joke nobody will laugh at. What a bomb. Well, we have two vital subjects going here. One deals with recoverable water pent up by the lithosphere. The other topic I wanted to discuss here deals with a huge and ever-increasing volume of pent-up water and also innumerable drinks. In non-degradable plastic containers or bottles, a vast amount of water increasing in a geometric progression at an alarming rate heretofore, as far as I can tell, virtually unnoticed. And that second huge volume of water is pent up by the retailosphere. The retailosphere. An almost unattainable part of the earth. Did I say that right? Almost unobtainable part of the earth. Unattainable, right? Even in a way, by the ultra-rich themselves. The only way for a reasoning a cosmos to free up that pent-up water is to literally melt the entire planet down. Possible? Yeah. In the meantime, an extremely huge volume of water flows underground. It should be enough for several times the existent population of all water-using life in the biosphere. It is as if, at this juncture in time, all life was dependent on man to get off his beastly bottom and do something about resupplying the biosphere with the adequate water supply it so vitally needs. And that is a highly conservative estimate. I discussed this phenomenon in my article, The Rehydration of the Oort Cloud. Recent discoveries in the composition of ice formations in extreme portions of the solar system tend to corroborate this. Then I asked sometime back in the 80s someone if he was going to tap into a huge underground ocean beneath the desert regions Oh, I got it. Wait a minute. I didn't ask him. Say, I never talked with Muammar Gaddafi. Muammar Gaddafi. But when someone asked back in the 80s, asked him if he was going to tap into that huge underground ocean beneath the desert regions of Libya, President Gaddafi replied that he wouldn't, and he cited erroneous scientific views at the time, much to the misfortune of Libya, which could have been an ultra extremely prosperous nation by now. Let's face it, you can't, you know, like, rely on oil revenues forever. It could have been by now the wheat basket and rice bowl of Africa and the Middle East, and that's just for openers. The misconception the self-righteous institutionalists' excuses for scientists handed the unsuspecting president, who apparently trusted their expertise, was that it was a non-renewable resource. Now, here's where the science of geology earns its spurs. The true geologist is able to calculate the difference between renewable and non-renewable. Why geologists? If it's underground, it's their department. Why not geologists? Their problem is they seem to have been fixated on solid rock or even magma or liquid rock, you know. And while it's hard to gauge what's going on so far down beneath any eyesight or measurement, even a wildcat oil driller should be able to tell you the difference between a stagnant subterranean ocean and a flowing one. What we need to establish is this new science, that is, is it a given that certain discernible large bodies of underground water are in motion, or fossil water in resupply, or are they stagnant reservoirs of fossil water that are unrenewable? In other words, these guys don't know. There was a situation in Texas sometime in the mid-20th century when they tapped into a large underground reservoir that was unrenewable. In that case, a very large volume of water was used for irrigation and other purposes, and the space made by the void of the water removed underground began to collapse. It's, as I always say, water you talking about. If you look at the surface features of Arizona and Texas, the Arizona and Texas region, you'll see that it's in the rain shadow of the Rocky Mountains, and therefore is most probably fed by rainfall, which would be over a large progression of time. It's a monsoonal rain flow in a dry region or in a rain shadow. But North Africa is fed by the African rivers, which disappear into the sand. It is possible to estimate the flow of the Wadi, or disappearing river phenomenon, especially now that we have satellites that can observe from a distance and use radar to see below sand for a while, for a number of feet. But we're only touching on the tip of the iceberg here, and dang, that iceberg is a stingy tipper, man. I'll tell you, to go back to my reference to the article, The Rehydration of the Art Cloud, this phenomenon seems to have happened to both Earth and Mars. Based on recent discoveries of the existence of water on Mars, which since has seemed to have disappeared, corroborating the postulation of surface lithotic hydrous retention. I mean, come on, folks. It's a big cosmos out there. Wake up. Switch off the entertainment center. Put away the missing links, phantoms, and hoaxes of the Pleistocene and Oligocene eras. Toss the 100-year-old theories into the shredder and start doing some useful science for a change. Let the other 50 million scientists keep searching for the billion-dollar golden BB, you know, such as the cure for cancer. There are enough good guys on that project. You know, get out there and do something a little more productive, like the total prosperity of a desperate planet Earth, you know, and maybe even the safe colonization of Mars by humans and flora and fauna. You know, let's, hey, we can get Schwarzenegger away from California. Maybe he can go out there and, you know, terraform Mars. Oops, not supposed to say that. I'm sorry. That's like... that movie was a little bit schmaltzy anyway. Okay, humankind really is an integral part of life in the biosphere of the planet Earth. You have to watch out for these don't interfere guys, like the green pizza and their death symbol. Yeah, I smell an ulterior motive with that group. You know, you can smell that stench 100 miles away, you know, like a love-hate relationship with nature, you know, with hate being the subterfugal motive and love being the PR cover-up, you know. It's not what they say, you know, it's not in what they say, it's in what they do. In many travels, my many travels over the past 3 decades around the planet Earth, I've noticed many disappointing aspects in the behavior of humankind. That's right, us. Also in the rest of the animal kingdom, but they have an excuse. After all, they're traumatized because they don't have human beings to care for them. You know, as the human beings were supposed to be doing, instead of hiding out in these death trap cities. Or screaming, "Leave nature alone!" So they could really slink out of the job, you know? Maybe they just don't get it. I admit, it takes some effort to catch on. You know, it may seem like I'm excluding myself from blame here, but I, like others, just didn't get it at first. We saw the growing deserts. We read about it in science class and in high school. We learned that many deserts of the world were actually created by man through such things as overgrazing of the wrong kind of livestock, deforestation, and many other things. You know, we saw the specials on TV, the documentaries, and so forth, you know, so on and so forth. And we tended to, you know, quote-unquote, blow it off, as everyone else did. Join the crowd. Be part of the herd. Participate in the oblivion. Also, when I began to see in the stores the availability of drinks of all types, and also now water in bottled plastic containers, you know, I mean, it's like back in the 50s, we used to have a canteen. You unscrewed it. It was, at first, they were metal. You unscrewed the top and filled it with tap water. Can you believe that? They said, that canteen, you carried that. You know, now these guys, look, I even have one in my belt. Look, I have a special attachment. I can put a plastic drink bottle in that. Instant canteen. Cost me $2 or something in the stores. Like, most of the time I can't afford that, so I just grab my plastic bottle and pour filter water in it, you know. So I have like a liter of water on my hip, ready to go at any time. It's like I don't, and people don't look at me like I'm some kind of camping freak, like back in the 60s. carry a canteen back then, they would have thought you a nutcase. You know, everybody like was totally dehydrated all the time. They only drank when they were thirsty. Can you believe that? Anyway, so, you know, I also began to see in the stores the availability of drinks of all type, also water bottled up in plastic containers. My only impression was, how convenient. But finally, after all my travels through areas made increasingly dry, as investigation eventually revealed at the hand of humans, I began to realize that it was also at the hand of humans that the problem could be solved. Yeah, it could be. It's going to take human beings to dig the wells, and it's also going to take human beings to open the bottles, restore the water, and recycle the containers. I mean, like, I was walking down the street last night. I said, wait a minute, stop, to my wife. Stop, Jen. There's a bottle of water. I picked it up. It was in the gutter. Open the lid. Pour the water back out. Release, 3 cups of water back into the hydrosphere. You know, back into the biosphere. I mean, you know, imagine that bottle now goes into the landfill and I hadn't dumped the water out. Somebody scooped it up, threw it in the trash. Good Samaritan did their good deed. The water is now buried in a landfill. You couldn't dig a well for that stuff. You imagine somebody going in there, digging up the landfill and unscrewing every cap. You talk about being unscrupulous. Think about it, buddy. You know, you multiply that by millions and billions. Nobody has the statistic on this. Maybe they wanted to bury it in their bookwork so nobody would notice. They're calling water blue gold, for crying out loud. Yeah, you check. You're looking at this picture of me in the video. What you're looking at is mostly water here. Motile, movable water. With very few other elements involved. It's a miracle of water, actually. And, you know, in 3 days, without water, no matter where you are on the face of the earth, that's it. You go home to the beyond. You know? We got a problem here, buddy. Big one, big time here. So, you know, I began to realize it was also at the hand of humans that the problem could be solved. Hand of humans caused the problem, hand of humans can solve it. It's going to take human beings to dig the wells, and it's also going to take human hands to open the bottles, restore the water, and recycle the containers. It's also going to take much research, to find out how to return the elements in the plastic back to the natural world. Oh yeah, but you want to be one of the wealthy, huh? You want to be one of those rich scientists, don't you? You want to be a yuppie, rich guy scientist. Losing removable hard drives, CDs, and who knows what else at good old Los Alamos, or hiding out in jet propulsion, basking in the shadow of your bought-off degree, unnoticed somewhere in the crowd, analyzing the chalk dust from Einstein's blackboard. You know, I want to tell you something, Mr. Adams. If it weren't for some of these poor scientists, altruistically motivated throughout history to the present, like Pierre and Marie Curie and so on, long ago, and many others, you'd probably be out of a job, wise guy. Yeah. Join the crowd with the rest of us in our little one-room rented apartments and make some discoveries for a while. or for a change. Hey, what's the matter? Afraid the scientific journal rags are going to nail you with their, good little conflict of interest button? Get him! He's doing some real science. Afraid to get financing for some science for a change, huh? Man, that's a scary prospect. That's going to actually take some real hard work. Tell the institutionalists to get out of your face. Get out there and do the real thing. If you're one of those boys who hawked his future for a master's degree, I'm sorry, son. We'll read about you in some also-ran journal somewhere. Most of the great scientists of history never had the blessing of the institutionalists. But if you're, some kid out there, maybe in the developing world, and you ain't got a chance of a snowball in hell of getting into any college, don't let that stop you. How about that? You don't even need a bachelor's degree to make a breakthrough. Anybody with some real ideas is never going to impress those deadheads anyway. While they're out there playing with their cyclotrons and their other toys, tricking the rich guys into subsidizing their chalkboard tic-tac-toe, you'll be out there making some real discoveries while they're in their Tomorrowland theme parks deluding themselves. I mean it, kid. Those guys have neutralized science for over 100 years. The real science was done in spite of them, and darn little of it. Leave them alone. Let them go ahead and have their mass meetings on how to discover 1,000 new ways to make plastic. You go on out there, kid, and do some real science, and you'll find out there is a universe of discovery right there in front of your nose once they get out of your face. Yeah. So, sorry about that blink. Sometimes if I just go like that, hey, whoa, I don't know, that's interesting, maybe some kind of like visual feedback there, huh? Mysterious feedback, I'm sure they explain that somewhere. Ah. Okay, Stagecoach North. So I think we're going to rove the eyeball here to take a look at some drawings. Okay. Leinster Meeting House. Let's see. I don't know if you can see this. Wonder if I'm pointing the camera at the right area. Is this Leinster? Little drawing of the Leinster Meeting House. Now you can tell I did this from a photograph I took of the Leinster Meeting House one day while I was commuting out there to try to go to a town near Concord, I think, in New Hampshire, from way off in the side of New Hampshire, a place called Claremont. And I just jumped out of the car and, with a chemical film camera, where it was pretty expensive to take a picture, so you had to be very careful. You couldn't take lots of pictures. And you can tell by the lens, this is the type of fisheye lens they have in those cameras. The tower does not actually curve like that. But I did the drawing freehand and ended up like... I think probably I could go through Photoshop and get that straightened out. Okay, that's the Lemster Meeting House. Okay. Let's go back. And we're going to take a look at the New London Inn here. This was taken... before they had a great big frost, and this tree was a lot... There's a lot more to this tree, I think, than later on. See all the cars parked in front. This is these were new cars back then. Probably people parking to either shop here at this little shop, or some of the employees were parked right outside. And this is a very old inn. This goes back a long ways. So let's see why I referred to these. This is a kind of a blue I use on my as a background for my texts. Call it eggshell blue. So that, you know, people, when they're, if they read these things, they're not going to get... I think the glare of the actual white of the that comes from the screen like that for a white page that people are reading all the time actually may hurt their eyes. So I thought of using a blue background. And I didn't do the science on it, so I don't know which is the optimum blue. Maybe it's kind of not a blue, but a gray or something. Or maybe... But... Anyway, so that drawing you saw, I hope you saw it, okay, the Lemster Meeting House and the New London Inn sort of go with a painting. Oh, so we have another reference here, High Water 96. This is the painting I did. Yeah, back when I was working on at the Mart, you know, I drove down to the bank during a break, lunch break. It's before they had direct deposit, so I was depositing my paycheck. At that time, I was earning about $12,000 a year. Unbelievable. I had to use science to extend my buying power, because I still managed to have a... be able to pay my mortgage on my only home that I ever owned. It was a mobile home, which we sold back in 2004 at a loss. Hey, you know, we got 8 years out of it. So this is during the spring thaw. The waters get higher on this. This is called the Sugar River, and this is an area that's actually a generator in there. It used to produce hydroelectricity, and this factory burned to the ground during the World War II era. And this was this and many other New England towns sprung up as industrial centers for back in the 1700s, I believe, where England outsourced labor to the colonies, and they used water power in the day. So there was a time where you had water wheels, and this river at this point would be a great power source for that. And that's a big deal. I don't have time to get into that part of it. It's interesting, this blue rock, it actually looked like that. It had this sort of layer of sediment in it. very beautiful color. I had a chance to study this rocks when the water was low and took a photograph. This is from a photograph, so I snapped this photograph on the bridge on the way to the bank, and it was unusually high that year. So this is called High Water 96 detail. It was done in spring of 96. This mountain in the back, I lived over there a little bit towards closer to this mountain. There's gold in this. It's actually a volcano in New Hampshire called Mount Escutney. Okay, so let's get back to the story. And control plus it. Boink, boink, boink. That's about good. And let's see what we have to say about this. I wrote this a while back, and I think it's 04, maybe 03. So I'm kind of refreshing my memory on this stuff. I'm awful glad I wrote these things down. This is a few times I had the chance to do that. So I did. Okay. Once again, Stagecoach North. Now, you always think of the Stagecoach as something out in West. In fact, when I was six years old in New Mexico, Dad used to take me every now and then, take the family down across the border into Mexico, old town, way up in the north. And they actually still had a Stagecoach back then in the 50s, 1952. And so I got to ride in a real old Stagecoach, one of the genuine articles. It was really quite interesting. I still remember that vividly, actually. Okay, anyway, the drawing, Leominster Meeting House in New London Inn that you just saw, hopefully, sort of go with my painting, High Water 96. The first two are about the Stagecoach North that connected Concord, New Hampshire, and points south of that. South of Concord with Canada. Okay. During the colonial days, the vast old-growth forests of New England supplied the masts of fleets and massive numbers of ocean-going vessels, all wind-powered in that era. The forests existent in much of New England, such as New Hampshire, are by and large new growth forests. In the early times of about the mid-20th century, vast swatches of the northeast landscape were virtually denuded. Now, about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I put up my sociological article. Sociology article, no denudes is good denudes. It still has zero views. Nobody is interested. That's amazing. Anyway, so you can make a statement, but you can't make them listen. But huge, vast swatches of northeast landscape were virtually denuded. The colonial days served as the China and Vietnam of the textile industry when England outsourced its labor of textile work to the colonial mills along the New England River ways. So you see, this outsourcing thing is nothing new. Here we see a characteristic of the dark side of the thought pattern of human nature. Factors at play that undertake to cause the collective human psyche to resort to the easiest conclusions. Being pressed to, as a sort of a routine of, as it were, inverted commas, quote-unquote, business as usual. Wow. I'll tell you, these laptops are killing me. Just got repetitive stress. Whew. Okay. But, of course, you have to cut those guys some slack. Back in those days, they had horrendously frightening survival situations that they had to face. In most instances, the only difference between them and the Native Americans in their proximity, they were still using Stone Age techniques, was the patterns of manufacture they brought with them. Aside from that, it was make everything from scratch, just as the Native Americans were doing. But of course, the settlers had the knowledge of metals and smithing and tool making and so on. In fact, if the two managed to blend a little better in those days, we might have come up with a stunning new sort of adaptation of European post-Bronze Age mechanization easing into the advent of steam power and iron in conjunction with the Native Americans' post-Stone Age concepts of being able to use stones for tools, which, by the way, was quite an accomplishment in more ways, far more sophisticated than the stamped-out smith-type tools that the colonists were wont to produce. So, if the two had blended and found common ground, we might have come up with a mélange between the European and the native, which, in speculation, would perhaps be a much more aesthetic, intrinsic, and artisaned type of productivity, with an uncanny ability to use the things immediately available in one's environment at any given time. But you see, from the days of the early history of what we may tend to think of as civilization, we see a dark side of humanity that tends to take shortcuts. Wow. Tends to take shortcuts and loses the extreme prosperity and productivity that could have rather been enjoyed in any given period of time. It is a case of misplaced priorities in which those persons who lack the creativity and foresight to take on positions of responsibility because of certain psychological limitations and dementia, for a variety of reasons, such as the need to compensate for lack of self-esteem, used an impressive and extraordinary degree of skill to, as I have said before, quote-unquote, worm their way into positions of responsibility, thus attaining the satisfaction of imagining themselves to be something, or persons of esteem, which in stark reality, and this is all throughout history, they were completely the opposite. So what we're confronting here, aside from the color and the interest of what really came to pass in history as a general study, is a stunning lackluster detail in history of underachievement and disappointment in the fields of any accomplishment in human endeavor on the part of the industrialists and their predecessors. In fact, strides must be taken quickly to interview the survivors of those bygone eras, the descendants of the Native Americans of colonial days, who still have fresh in their knowledge the remnants of the know-how their ancestors passed on to them of the skills to be able to make from scratch a middle-class type existence out of nothing at all except the stones and natural material found around you in the environment. So, in those days, in the 1700s, as in the entire colonial era, starting in the 1600s and extending to the early 19th century, or the 1800s, as we are speaking of it now, the stagecoach was mostly associated in the memory of most people as that conveyance of transportation glamorized by the cowboy movies in the mid-20th century. Oops, I kicked the stand again. Okay, the cowboy movies of mid-20th century, which was a more comfortable way to transport oneself across the United States during the times of the Wild West, when the country's territory first extended from coast to coast. However, it is forgotten that this lovely, romantic, and oft-times rather elegant form of transportation had been going on for quite some time, not only in the Americas, but also elsewhere, including in the old country back in Europe. Here, in this instance, I referred to in this article, the stage ran from Boston through New England diagonally until it reached the colonies in Canada. Personages of all descriptions would ride the stagecoach through the colonial city of Concord, now the capital of New Hampshire, eventually wending their way up through Leinster and New London, continuing on through the territories which now constitute the state of Vermont, and on up to Canada. Of course, there were all sorts of other conveyances, including horseback, that used the same public road as the stagecoach, but it was the stagecoach, with its comfort and elegance, with springs to absorb the shock and the bumps along the way, that really made this route and others throughout the colonial territories and other places in the world, even the old country of Europe, that made each of these routes into the renowned roads they once were, making them extremely important. Of course, many of these routes, like this famous stagecoach route through New England and most others, for example, the King's Highway through the forest of Rennes outside of Paris in Europe, are now nothing more than secondary or tertiary roads. When I was a child, I had the opportunity to ride in a stagecoach, quite an enjoyable and thrilling ride, especially for a little six-year-old kid. It was, actually it was in Mexico, but I was saying here it was in New Mexico. And although the trip was a short one, intended only for the interest and attraction of tourists, the little stagecoach ride, we only went a couple hundred feet, it was so momentous for me that it's remained fairly prominent in my memory to this day. Now, here is a wry point to this article, and one that might seem a bit unpleasant to you if you, like me, have ancestors like mine, the Halls and the Walkers, who helped colonize New England from the early colonial days in the 1600s, when they eventually used these roads to get from the original settlements up toward Canada. In the case of the Halls and Walkers, southern New Hampshire, with some Canadians mixed in who made the trip down from up north. You see, a lot of people are blaming global warming on greenhouse gases, and while it's true that man's industrialization has produced a preponderance of such gases, such as the famous carbon dioxide, humankind, in its usual classic underachieving way, falls far short of being able to ascertain the true essence of the dilemma. It's the trees, stupid! The trees! I have made my way in detailed travels twice around this planet. What I have seen in essence is a denuded landscape. Since mankind perfected the axe, and I'm not talking about the stone axe, but rather the iron and later the steel axe to the modern day chainsaw, it has been in the process of giving our old planet Earth a crew cut. The landscape has been denuded of trees. Humankind has reached out, taken hold with their hands, and stripped the landscape of all its sylvan nobility and quality. But we're not just talking aesthetics here. As a child in the German city of Bad Homburg in Germany, I had the opportunity to take Sunday jaunts with my family, joining scores of Germanic families down ancient pathways through glorious old pine forests. Somehow these people, the Germanic peoples of Bad Homburg, had stepped back and exercised the deeper insight into the dilemma of humankind, the tendency to denude the land of all forests, and had hung on to theirs, at least then. That was back in the 50s. Of course, they even lost a lot of forest to the dilemma of acid rain coming from industrial areas elsewhere. I can remember later in New England in Oxfordshire enjoying wonderful times hiking through the forest of St. James Forest, south of Oxford along the Thames. Northwest out there along the Thames, I lived there and I can't remember the name now. Take me 20 seconds to remember, so we don't have time. Anyway, those more pleasant jaunts came to an abrupt end, as at least half of the forest, I mean, it was old growth, half of the forest was clear cut. For what reason? I know not. That was back in 1971 when I was out there. 1971. Dagnabbit. You know? Anyway. But since tree fellers began to catch up with growth space and ultimately surpass it, the process of global warming has taken its toll. And was on the increase, unnoticed until now. Now, even now, a lot of the industrialists are trying to pretend not to notice it. I mean, they'll do anything to hang on to their money bags, man. You know, this is absolutely pathetic. Anyway, and even now, the cheap shot politicians are taking their shortcuts to the easiest thing to blame. But if you set up the tests, the instrumentation, and run the experiments and do the science, I believe you will find that even with industrialization out of the picture, the deforestation alone would have more slowly caused, but nevertheless caused anyway, the phenomenon of global warming we now see. Even without man lighting so much as a campfire, just from the emissions alone of all animal life producing methane gas as a part of their digestive process, or more delicately put, as they more delicately put, quote-unquote, break wind, that alone would have been sufficient to cause your three-alarm global warming scenario, you know, you now at last have finally started to scream about, simply because of the lack of trees It's the trees, stupid. It's the trees, or rather, the lack of them. The trees are what process the carbon dioxide. You have stripped the landscape of its trees. But now, even existing forests have trees concentrated within them, that if you thinned out the trees in those forests, it would not only help the forest to grow much better, but if you transplanted those trees using the powerful, and I went over this in the last article, the powerful mechanization you now have at your disposal, and the horticultural advancement that promotes the planting of full-growth trees, you would find that you would be able to reestablish more than three-quarters of the lost forests of the earth that had vanished in the last 300 years. And global warming would be almost completely brought under control. Now, how about that? That wasn't so hard, was it? So, get to it. It's going to create a lot of jobs, and the pruning alone of the hardwood trees after the reforestation would provide the lumber industry, the furniture industry, and subsistence civilizations of the world, and anyone else who uses hardwood for fire, all the wood, lumber, and fuel they would need to live happily ever after. Already went over that. Unless, of course, a bunch more small-time politicians and weasels manage to worm their way into positions of importance on your watch and start to lean on clear-cut lumber for a cash crop. You know. And now we see the Kyoto Accord. Now, that was back then. They had this Kyoto Accord. Oh, my God. I don't believe these guys. Now we see the Kyoto Accord weasels running around with boxes full of Band-Aid quick fixes and feel-good solutions for the folks back home so they can return conquering heroes with what a good boy am I expression on their smirk faces, with the exception of a select few who, in spite of genuine concerns, understandably have not had sufficient time nor adequate counsel to seriously reflect on the actual problem itself. I probably would have come to similar conclusions myself, since I also am an ordinary person like all the rest of them. However, I had a bit of space to reflect on the matter and experienced also my set of shocks over the conclusion that, just a little bit of reflection can give, especially on a situation like this. I have said it to myself, and I say it to all. It's the trees, stupid. We are about to face a more horrendous, atrocious, unbelievably disastrous situation than we would have ever faced had we done nothing more than continue business as usual. The ramifications of the Kyoto Accord and others like it, produced by rash politicians and quick fixers and the like, is to begin to sequester carbon dioxide, as I have said in other articles, and I repeat it here, because of the disastrous consequences we face, burying it underground to become cave acid, carbonic acid, producing a planet Earth in which its wealthy few can afford to survive all else, suffocate from lack of oxygen. Yeah, they're not going to be able to deal with that one. Even if they could afford it, they're probably too stupid. By then, a part of that carbon dioxide sequestered underground. It's like, oh, what happened to our oxygen? Oh, you buried it, you moron. You buried it. Now, what are they going to do to a people like that? Oh, we're okay. We followed the Kyoto Accord to the letter. We've buried our carbon monoxide. All of the industrial gases are put straight underground, never to return again. You know what they're going to do? You take their oxygen away from you, they will nuke you. They will nuke the bastards. That's all I can say. It's like they'll be doing it in self-defense. What can I tell you? Collateral damage, man. You take their life breath away from them, what do you think they're going to do? To stand around and say, oh, well, the United States does get like 40% of all energy. Just lay down and die? You know?
We expect the poor to die for America.
You gotta be kidding me, man. They're gonna nuke your ass. Unless you snap out of it right now. It's the trees, stupid. The trees, right? The ancestors who took that stagecoach north enjoyed a more abundant oxygenation in their lungs than we have ever known in our present situation. But that, even that, pales in comparison to the stifling, suffocating atmosphere where those who cannot afford to buy oxygen or run out of their supply in some isolated area where they can't get a refill will risk death should they get to this, you know, get the slightest bit winded or out of breath. Now that's a shock that will literally take your breath away. Better bone up on the state of the art in producing oxygen, because it won't be long, Jack, before you won't have enough air to breathe for free. End of story. Sorry about the happily ever after bit. Not enough band-aids for that one, buddy. Batters. It's more serious than it appears to be, as usual. Bat batters. Quixotic windmills. Boy, this one is going to make a big hit. You know, what bowls me over is all this self-righteousness these guys are coming down with all over the landscape, in their effort to disguise the fact of their willful ignorance. Now, you know, ignorance is excusable. Willful ignorance, on the other hand, like, come on, man. Or even the reality that they themselves have participated in their own dementing debilitation. And here come the Europeans, man. Here come the Europeans, the last ones on Earth, I would have suspected. Champions of carbon dioxide sequestration. and reduction of greenhouse gases. And now our beloved wind generators are turning out to be, you know, a disaster. Yeah, that's right. I wouldn't say even our beloveds. Like, I thought when I first saw these things go up, I said, somebody's really starting to really get creative here. Then I began to get like a eerie feeling about this. Like, it's like getting out of hand here. I mean, I developed a windmill that actually amplifies the available wind. It was one of the projects I worked on when I was like 16. I never had a chance to build it. Yeah. Oh, I'm 16 years old. I'd like to work on this windmill here back in 64. Can I have like $5 million and grant in the form of like grants and I need about 30 or 40 interns from MIT. in your dreams. The only thing I had in my dreams was I remember one time I dreamt that I got married, settled down, had a family, even a pet dog, huge, big, fuzzy dog. Was married for like, I don't know, like 15 years. That was some dream, huh? 15 years. Yeah. And then, you know, my wife came to me in tears and said, "I'll never see you again." I said, What are you talking about? And then I hear, "Paul, time to get up." I said, "You're kidding me." She said, "No." And I said, "You just wait right there. I'll be right back. I'll be right back." You know, and I half woke up and said, "Okay, I'm up." Then I went back to sleep. Got back into the same dream. And I mean, it was like horrific. I said, "I don't care what happens, I'll find you wherever you are. Da da da." You know, talk about the Twilight Zone episode. That would be a good episode. You know, it's kind of like one of these things where he's, you know, like happily married, wife, family, everything, and even pet dog, and then you wake up. Yeah, 1964. No, it was 65. I remember. I think I do. It's a long time ago. No. Kennedy had been assassinated. I knew what that was. I mean, I didn't know what it was, but I could sense it. I could sense that this was really something. It's like a turning point. But later on, in my late 20s, I began to learn about the futility of the whole thing anyway. This is like sort of almost destined to happen here. Anyway, so enter the windmill. But this has got a dark side to it. Unbelievable. You know. And of all people, the Europeans, you know. I reiterate this thing about carbon dioxide sequestration, which is like, where did they get this word sequester from? This, you know, I think, you know, part of the science of getting away with things is to hide the terminology in such obscure language that nobody ever bothers to find out. You know, it would be too boring, it would be deadly, you know. They're burying carbon dioxide. I don't know how successful these guys are doing this, but apparently they are. bearing this in huge quantities. I don't know if it's made a dent now because, you know, I don't know if any of the real capable scientists that are out actually doing things are able to have been able to come up with the instrumentation for this. But you see, anybody who's had elementary science, you could tell the public really never bothered, you know, quote unquote. Or this thing would have been put down a long time ago. You see, when I take a breath, I'm breathing a mixture of gases here in the atmosphere, but among them is the gas oxygen, which is used for brain function, bodily functions, that my very motility is dependent on oxidation here. Now, I breathe out carbolic acid, H2CO3. You know, like, hope I got that right. You know, see me, you know, clean my glasses by putting my breath on the lenses, and it's a kind of cleaner. I never forget when my mom taught me that when I was about 4 years old. I needed, you know, like, I was, like, for about 6 months after there, my major duty, self-assigned, was cleaning every pair of glasses I could find. Of course, you can't do that now, because you have to have, like, with plastic lenses, you have to have microfiber, or else you scratch the plastic. Yeah, life just got complicated. Complicated. More like calm and placated. It got complicated. So, okay. Carbon dioxide that they bury and cannot extricate. I mean, can these guys say, whoops, my mistake, delete. Let's bring this carbon dioxide back up, process it, and release the oxygen back into the air. No. What's happening is carbon dioxide is a large part oxygen. So they are actually taking the oxygen out of the atmosphere. And, you know, with all this deforestation, you know, come on, kid. I mean, I drove through the, you know, like, boreal forest. First of all, it's just about gone from blight, which means it's being replaced by the soft woods, quick-growing trees, I get it, 20 seconds, and I can remember anything just about for now. Birch, you know, birch trees. I've seen it. So what's happening is the ecology is changing, probably because of global warming. Also, I'm going to get into this a little later, probably in the medicine section. I think one of the causes for the epidemic of obesity in almost planet-wide these days, except for people who are really starving to death in developing nations and things, is the temperature is going up. So people are not using the carbohydrates as fast, and yet they have the genetic, quote-unquote, genetic memory of intake of a lot of carbs. So the stomach is programmed to be pretty busy taking in those carbs to meet the demands of a cooler, more ice age exiting type environment. So here we're getting back to this carbon dioxide sequestration. So, I mean, these guys, to make a buck, they don't, it's like they don't see air, so, you know. And some of these scientists are so bought off, they'll do anything. You know what's going to happen when they get to a certain point where the oxygen level goes down? You will not have humanity. Humanity is oxygen dependent for its brain. You might have something that doesn't have much brains. I don't know what, maybe insects that would survive in an oxygen depraved environment. Planetary. Plants, I guess, trees. You know, that may already be happening. People may actually be having less cognitive ability due to a lack of oxygen. I mean, maybe it's negligible, but, I mean, you see, that's one thing. It's like the Europeans, you know, the thing is that there is no room in science for self-righteousness. And there's no room in politics for amateurs. Now that's the problem, is the amateur usually wins. They're usually amateur at being politicians, but professional at winning elections. You know? Say anything, and then they're in office, and the only thing they can do is pretend. You know? Okay, so all that aside, now we're dealing with this problem of the wind generators. Now your beloved wind generators are turning out to be a greater ecological disaster than ever. Didn't it ever occur to you idiots that the problem lies in deforestation? Haven't you done the homework or even the science? What's wrong with you people? The biggest culprit of the greenhouse dilemma is your own destruction of forests to line your greedy, self-righteous pockets. Now, you know what? I was getting inundated by junk mail. I never used any credit until finally I had to return from my travels and take care of my poor aging mother. So, of course, when I applied for the credit card, I had A1, number one, top credit. It was almost like I was fiction. It's almost like that doesn't exist. I became the target of every junk mail in my local section of the universe. And, where was the paper coming from? I found out, indirectly, a lot of it came from the boreal forests of Canada. So, like, the boreal forest was migrating to my mailbox in a kind of a poetic, indirect manner of speaking, but you see what was going on. I mean, you've got some nutty business people who really shouldn't be in that business anyway. They should have their licenses revoked, if that were possible. They're, causing this ecological disaster so they could make a quick buck. What's the problem here, man? Forests safely control carbon dioxide and keep it under control by housing the carbon in the wood and the fruits and the nuts. And also, by the way, they naturally sequester carbon dioxide in the ground, in the soil, later to be released upon the need. So, I have this memory. You may attribute it to quote-unquote overactive imaginations. The detractors are beginning to materialize now. I'm so shocked, in a way, because I only get one or two visits to each of my these videos. How the heck did these guys find out about me? They must have a bunch of... I mean, the impression is that there's some sort of watchdog group out there that jumps all over somebody who says, well, maybe, have you ever thought of it looking at it this way? Clomp, clomp, clomp. So, you know what? I mean, this whole thing would be worth it just to find out if that's the case and who the hell those asses, jackasses are. Anyway, they also safely, they found that out. They do have some old growth forest left in the United States. It's, whatchamacallit, University. Cambridge, USA Cambridge University. In I know they have one in England, the original. I know I visited Cambridge once. I went to Oxford in England, and I learned to punt the boat. This is fantastic, because I used to be a pole vaulter in high school, and you use the same muscles to punt with the punt pole. And I learned how to punt and use the buoyancy in the water to lift the pole up at the right angle, so the pole would shoot up into the air. I would catch it, plant it back down, and do pole vault. And I could make that boat go. It was so much fun. And I didn't know why people were criticizing me. I thought, oh, perhaps I'm going too fast, is it? There's no chap. You're punting on the wrong side of the boat. I said, what the hell difference does it make what side of the boat? Well, that's the Cambridge side. You're in Oxford. I said, oh my God. It's like, a year later I was out of there, man. It's like, okay, hit the road, man. I'm going to become a road scholar. I found out some stuff out there, too. They don't teach that kind of thing in university. Thank you very much. But anyway, so, so Cambridge, they found out that some guys actually did some good science, and they began to find out that the trees naturally sequester the carbon dioxide actually in the soil around the roots. And, of course, there's a lot more to be, but that's very exciting. It reminds me of the beekeepers that are having trouble with their bees, you know. Do a little science on it, you begin to find out that, you know, you're doing a monoculture of the apiaries, you know. What they need to do is bring in some of the bees from Alaska. And then what happens is don't get the African bees in there. Some guy tried to mix the African bees in with the honeybee, and they came up with a very dangerous type of insect there. But the more robust Alaska bee might be resistant to this kind of... I'm trying to cover a few subjects in here because I don't know if I'll be able to do that, you know, later on. So, anyway. So, the biggest culprit of the greenhouse dilemma is your own deforestation of forests to line your greedy, self-righteous pockets. You know, the forests also help to move the water back to the atmosphere for rainfall somewhere else. But the greedy politicians and business persons see the trees as a cash crop for lumber, until the whole landscape looks like a butch haircut. I mean, you better get this whole thing out of the hands of the politicians. Forget your green parties. There's no way to politicize this. Just let the politicians play in their sandboxes with their laws and taxes. Let the people get along despite them, and leave the serious stuff to the scientists. It's quite simple. Maybe that's your problem. You're so used to having things complicated or desiring to show off and be complicated and try to pretend to be so smart. That's the problem. I have a lot of critics out there. Oh, you can't say this stuff. You don't have the degree or the diploma, you know. Well, you know, hey, you know, a little information does help and go a long way. You know, I had to clue them in. I said, listen, you know, just like the big part of science is not the education. I mean, you need that. But, you know, You've got to go through your society and find all the people with a very high IQ, because the high IQ is the part that really makes the science happen. You've got to have genius. So, you know, all your great scientists, your Goddards, your DaVincis, you know, they're out there, garage mechanic, retail, cooking, maybe some guy's driving a garbage truck or a moving van. While you have this elitist society of educated people, because, I don't know, mom and dad were rich enough for them to get their master's degree, you know, and either that or they went in hock up to their eyeballs and became doctors of medicine instead of like a scientist or humanities or something that they were really good at. So this stuff is not working out the idyllic way it's proposed to be. That's what I'm trying to say here, you know. So, you know, it takes a lot more to be a real scientist than just a mere education. You know, so if you can, like, sit in your college, as Woody Guthrie said, and buy your degree, you know, that's not going to make you a scientist. You may be able to mix a few chemicals. You may be able to find out how to use halogens to pollute the ionosphere. But for crying out loud, kid, you know, it's like, step aside and let the geniuses do the science. Because this is what it takes, you know. Okay, so anyway, you know, so you know, take this thing out of the hands of the politicians, you know. Leave the serious stuff to the scientists. I mean the real scientists, the ones with the brains and the inspiration, you know. So simplicity, maybe that's your problem, you know. That people are trying to show off, you know. Well, the Cretaceous era, the Pleistocene, the Oligocene, the Eocene, the Iocene, the Pleistocene, the Kerosene, you know. Give me a break, man. It better be a Jake break. I'm going down a steep hill here. Whew. When I go uphill, this is really a pill, huh? Okay. When all you needed was not so much, even intelligence isn't going to make it with science. You have to have intuition. So what you needed was not so much smarts as intuition. You know, for every car on the road, you should have at least 30 trees. 100 would be better, but 30 is doable. Now, what's so hard about that? What's your problem? 30 trees for every car, no big deal. Piece of cake. Instead of going around with your self-righteous carbon dioxide sequestration, just go ahead and plant 30 trees per car. And if you can't do it, feed the squirrels real seed nuts, and they'll go ahead and plant the trees for you in the neighbor's backyard where you couldn't even go. They could go where, you know, like in the neighbor's flower plot where angels fear to tread. You know, for crying out loud, back when I was a kid and earning my pioneering merit badge for my Eagle Scout, you know, badge award, I learned in the field how densely trees tend to grow in the wild. Now, I realize your green pizza false doctrine is to leave nature alone and have nothing to do with it, but in reality, the human being is a part of nature. And it's like, hey, this stuff is organic, right? We're part of the animal kingdom. It's part of nature. Get it, duh. You know, the human being is a part of nature and needs to lend a hand in thinning out a naturally dense and overgrown forest using power equipment and powerful earth movers and trucking and even helicopters and other paraphernalia. It is possible to thin out a forest, removing the trees to be thinned out in such a way that you can transplant them elsewhere. Adult trees or even large saplings can be planted in their new location all over the planet. Yeah, you know, I mean, has anybody done that yet? So, I mean, can they definitively say, oh, the tree can only be so big and then it never could be transplanted again if you do this? Not with a huge, I'm saying with a huge, powerful earth mover. You've got to, you get down to the right, down to the whole root ball. You move the whole thing. They have equipment that can do that. And you get in there, thin the forest out so it grows more, a more healthy growing forest, and remove the trees that have already been adult trees, and put them in some other place. One overgrown forest could probably spread out maybe 1,000 times its distance. You know, and by spreading out and thinning out the forest, you could have stuff working between the forest. I actually saw stuff like that in Japan just the other day. How did I do that? Well, I was using the map section of there, and you know how when you use the edit feature on your videos on YouTube, they have a little section saying, okay, location here. See, so it's location, location, location. You type in your location and you get this little map, right, from Google Maps, right? And now you can use that as kind of like, I know there's other ones you can do, but I haven't had time to find them, you know. But using just that Google Map thing right there in the YouTube, I went over and I had a look at Japan. Well, there's just... Ah, there's Japan! Let's close in on it! Oh, look at that pattern up there. It must be a city. Getting closer. It is farms with trees bordering every field in perfect symmetry. It was incredible, like a work of art seen from outer space. You gotta check this thing out, man. So, you know. It's probably already being done, see? So, you can thin out a forest and it will spread. So the plantation is already there. All you have to do is work with the machinery, right? Okay. It is also possible to improve the architecture of housing, to armor the roofing, so that houses can exist amongst trees. If a branch or even a tree falls on a house, no damage occurs. I know, because we used to live under these big pine trees, and they practically demolished my mobile home one time during a wet snow. So, hi, buddy. Okay. So, you know, other housing can become, you know, like, so you can have architecture in a forest among the thinned trees. You know, you can't really have, you know, the arborist has to remove the tree area from any proximity to a normal house, because the branches eventually could fall and cause a lot extensive damage to the roof. damage that an average homeowner would be, it would really make a bad impact on their budget. And people live in a monetary world right now, which is not a good idea. But anyway, so the average homeowner couldn't just go ahead and repair it themselves. It cost a huge amount of money, an inordinately exorbitant amount of money. But you can armor the roofing of houses, or other housing can become subterranean, saving a lot of energy. Since the underground is actually warmer than winter and cooler than summer, if you want to be ecological, it may as well be for the real thing, remember, stupidity is no excuse, especially for you, because, I'm assuming you out there, you're not stupid. Destabilized, maybe. But destabilization is undoable. At least I believe it is, I hope these guys are not beyond treatment. That would be even a worse nightmare. Okay. It's not that hard to do. And think of all the job creation it would entail to produce vibrant natural forests with plenty of healthy transplants for many more new ones. You don't have the acreage for huge new forests, huh? Sure you do. Striate them. Look at that thing in northern Japan. Just zoom in on Japan, you'll see it. These guys are actually doing that, except their land plots are too big in the middle. Striate them among existent human communities, Forests can be striated in huge stripes between fields and populated areas or industrial areas or any combination thereof, and so on. Some could be put in on the open seas, Yeah. You imagine having a forest on the sea. Put them on huge forest carriers. You have aircraft carriers. These are forest carriers. And trees can be genetically altered to exist above timber lines. Mountain trees. Put that in the politician's pipe and let them smoke that and drag the green pizzas out of the courtroom and let them plant a few trees and do some ecological work for a change. Every last remnant of the unemployed could have a job. It would even be permissible to carefully harvest selectively the new forests, and whole populations could use the prunings of the hardwood for furniture and firewood. Now, somebody comes up with a neat design for a wind electricity generator about 30 years ago, and nobody improves on the design. But the politicians get so self-righteous about polluting the atmosphere that they fill the sky with these antique wind generators and wipe out whole bird populations and then polish off their dastardly self-righteousness by destroying huge flocks of bats at night. The same lethal apparatus does it all. Remember the Murphy's Law concept, in that everything you do will tend to backfire on you if you don't watch it. Didn't it occur to you guys that you could build, that you could house the moving vanes of the windmill? Huh? by putting a cowling around the windmill, you can actually enhance or focus the wind power. Talk about 30 years old designs. I've been working on that one since I was a teenager, as I said before. Now, I have my own design, which I'm not going to tell you about, because I was saving that one for an application someday that I might actually be able to patent. But in the meantime, we'll see if you can come up with something more innovative than that vertical helicopter that you have that's been clobbering all those birds and bats. Now, you know the bat has adapted over the eons to work on a sonar system. Well, not sonar, but a sort of radar system where everything in nature travels in a random manner and where nothing moves laterally as quickly as a windmill generator blade does. I mean, you can say, whoosh, whoosh. Well, that's pretty fast in, you know, like the biological world of the bat. So when the bat, quote-unquote, sees with his radar ability the blade it's flying by, its radar ability is actually sonar. So radar would be a microwave. Its sonar abilities in no way let it know how fast that blade is going. Elusively causing the blade, which seems to be safely to one side, to smack the little guy right out of the sky. Now, I've actually seen a video of a buzzard flying into one of these blades. Didn't even know it was there. Now, you even have problems with wires, with hawks and eagles. You know? So the bat needs to know it's going to be right in front of a blade to avoid a collision or even getting chopped in half. This has always been a problem. It's always been a problem. Man's or humankind's infatuation with the propeller. For example, the outboard propeller, the outboard motor, marine motor outboard propeller, and the manatee. The other problem is that the propeller is designed wrong. But that's another topic. We'll get to that hopefully later. You know, before my detractors persuade most of you that or dissuade you from, you know, with their unbelievable propaganda campaigns they come up with to not even look at my videos anymore, and most of the zombies will follow them. It's like, hey, I don't care, buddy. I'll post my video anyway and see if anybody watches it. Who knows? Anyway, it is impossible to just step back and let your intuition, as I say, let me just read that again. It is possible to just step back and let your intuition, which you, whoever you are, which you have in abundance, come up with something a bit more radical and a bit more novelistic and a bit more, shall we use the word, biological. What's wrong with that? You are biological, right? Huh? Maybe your shampoo isn't, or something else like your synthetic clothing. But you are, yeah, you're biological in the meantime. house the blades. Use cowling to enhance the wind power and cover the forward edge of the mill with a grill. Too expensive? Then, decelerate the rotation of the blades. Use larger blades like those old Dutch windmills. And gear ratios inside the tower to increase the spin rate of the generator. It's also possible to make blades out of soft material that the poor animals can bonk into and not get a headache. I know. Deer whistles on the tips, you know, like, that's another idea. But all kidding aside, all that to say this. There's really no such thing as the easy solution. Before that loudmouth kid starts to pretend he or she can save the world, let them do a bit of homework first about the realities of the real world beyond the confines of their dinky pop culture.